Hey everyone, and welcome to the Cheyenne Hills Podcast, Verse by Verse. We know it's often hard to find time to spend studying God's Word, so we're happy you can join us as we read, unpack, and discuss Scripture every Tuesday and Thursday. We hope you enjoy the program.
Across the street and around the world, Cheyenne Hills.
Hello everybody, and welcome to Plowing Through Genesis, and we're back. And I say we're back, it's like we're all new faces almost. I've been gone for a while.
That's right, welcome back.
You've been continue to plow through, you and Ken.
Yes.
Way to go. And today, Austin. Welcome, Austin.
Thank you.
Is this your first time?
Second podcast.
You've done, first one with Genesis.
First one with Genesis. I've been listening since June, though.
No kidding. So yes. You kind of know what we're doing.
Yes.
Okay, well, you want to fix anything we've already messed up?
So far, you are totally as confused as I am.
Well, I'm glad. So do you guys, you talk about messed up families. We're right in the midst of dysfunctional families.
It makes me feel much better about mine.
there's a line in Lion King. Of course, we go to Lion King a lot because, that's just like the metaphor, right? Because everybody knows it. But what's the bird's name? You remember the bird? Oh, shouldn't have done this to you guys. But okay, so he was talking to Mufasa. And Scar was walking away, and he says, there's one in every family, sire.
Yes.
Two in mine, actually. And it's one of my favorites. Like, yeah, everybody's got one or two. And well, Jacob's got like a bunch. His father-in-law is a mess. He's a mess.
He's a mess. And his two wives, Leah and Rachel, are at each other trying to have more babies than each other. And they're kind of jealous of each other.
It's true.
So, yeah.
This is a mess.
It's a mess. And Jacob's trying to figure out, how can I get out of this? So where we left off was that he goes to Laban and says, hey, how about I increase, you can have these type of sheep and goats and I'll have this type of sheep and goats. And Laban kept switching. And first I'm not going to get the order right, but Laban would switch and God would still increase Jacob's herd.
Right.
So that's
so no matter what Laban did. And so, but what I think is interesting, I mean, Jacob was the deceiver from day one. He was grabbing his brother's heel. He was a heel grabber. And he ended up, getting his birthright out of a bowl of lentil stew, and then he got his dad's blessing, and then he just went from there, and he was on the run from Esau. His mom sent him off, said, hey, your brother's going to kill you. Go to my father's family and across the way. And this is quite a ways. I mean, I'm not exactly sure, probably in that Fertile Crescent area. It's up Haran.
Well, yeah, it's kind of going back towards Abraham's family, because that's where Abraham originally sends his servant to go get Isaac's wife.
That's right. No, you're exactly right. And so there's all this activity that kind of goes, they kind of go back to finding, I don't know, their own kin, if you will. Mm-hmm. And so it all makes kind of sense, but it's a dysfunctional lot of people. And so you guys covered through 16 and we're going to pick up the action at verse 17. So Genesis 31:17, it goes this: then Jacob arose and put his children and his wives upon the camels, and he drove away all his livestock and all his property which he had gathered, his acquired livestock which he had gathered in Paddan Aram, to go to the land of Canaan to his father Isaac. When Laban had gone to shear his flock, and Rachel stole the household idols that were in his father's house. And Jacob deceived Laban, the Aramean, by not telling him that he was fleeing. So he fled with all that he had, and he arose, and he crossed the Euphrates River, and he set his face toward the hill country of Gilead. So, okay, so he's been there, I think, 20 years.
Yeah.
Now, he's been deceived by Laban. Laban said, okay, you're going to get to marry Rachel, I think it's where you wanted to marry.
That was the first one, yeah.
That was the first time. And he tricked, Laban tricked him by having her with a veil. And it wasn't until his wedding night, the way I understand it, that he raised the veil and was like, wow, this is not the woman that I thought I was marrying. He got the sister that was not
nobody
as...
nobody really wanted at that point.
It wasn't as attractive apparently to him. And so he said, well, if then work for another 7 years, and then you can have Rachel as his wife. And so... so he works another 7 years, and then he gets Rachel, his wife, and then he has to work another hunk of time so he can get these flocks. And that's what you were saying. They were the breeding is, if you do the X's and Y's and all that, whatever you could, not male, female, but the spot versus not spot or stripes.
Phenotypic, all that square stuff. Thingy.
Yeah. Yeah. And so whatever the ratio was, they were all coming up spotted.
Yeah.
Or they were all coming up striped, or they were all, and it came up no matter what happened, how the cards were dealt. Aces were always falling in Jacob's hand, and just drove Laban crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So anyway, so this is the action. So I think he kind of felt like it'd probably be best if he just kind of sneaks out of town.
Right. I think he felt like, he'd been working for all of this, and he was trying to find a way out because he felt like he'd been used and not dealt with fairly. And it didn't. The future didn't look very good for him. So I think he was looking for a way to get out and start his own herd.
Well, and I think what we see is, during this whole times of sticks and everything, he says, well, God showed me that I'm supposed to leave. But of course, with their family, it's like, yeah, God said to go do something, but then I'm going to do it in the most dishonest way possible, almost. It's like,
Sneaky.
It's like, God said I should leave. But instead of just saying, hey, Laban, like, I got to go back to my land. I'm going to take my flock now. He's just like, hey, he's gone. He's going to be over in the hills, shearing all my sheep and all his sheep, technically. And so I'm just going to get out right now, because he's going to be gone for a couple days.
Yeah.
And so, everything is still dishonest. Almost everything from Jacob.
That's a good point. It's just like that's kind of how a lie is, isn't it? I mean, it's like you start off with a lie and you got to continue this lie. It's kind of with the deception as well. It's like this is the way they both dealt with each other out of this deceptiveness. I mean, you can't fault Jacob from being frustrated for it's like, hey, I kind of worked here for 20 years and you still haven't, you tricked me 10 times. I think it says a little bit later, we're going to see that. And, there's this frustration that they both have. But there's this interesting point that is brought up here. When Laban had gone off to shear his flocks, then Rachel stole the household idols that were her father's. It's like it's a little bit of, okay, who are these household idols? What are these household idols? And why is Rachel taking them?
Well, you kind of get a confirmation, of your guess of where they're at, because it says he crosses the Euphrates. So they are definitely in that Fertile Crescent. And they're in Babylon, more or less.
Right?
Yeah, that area. And so whatever household gods, I know that you did the digging work and said that it's the teraphim.
Yes. And so I want to give credit to Ken Will. He had done some research through the Bible Knowledge Commentary, and it says that the household gods, which were actually called teraphim, might have meant the right to inheritance. So it meant that Rachel was trying to take what was hers, and she felt like maybe she felt like she had been cheated out of an inheritance. So those gods stood for something that was important to her family.
Well, that not only that, if you guys looking up that word when you told me that, when you look at Judges, Ezekiel, some of the later judgments, when it talks about household idols and household gods, it's using that same word that Israel continues to fall into that sin of saying, well, no, I want mine, not what God has for me, but what is my family's, or what Rachel is saying, I want mine.
Right.
Well, and it's the number one command. It's like, do not have any idols before me, nothing else before me. And it's like the one thing that humanity wants to do is to have their own little way of idolatry, or of little of a rabbit's foot. We look at idols and we can camp on this just a little bit, but you look at that and you're like, well, gosh, I would never do that. But I think we all have if you really dig, we all have a little bit of, knock on wood.
Mm-hmm.
Where did that come from? That's kind of a goofy thing.
Right.
It's like, okay, since I knocked on wood, this
isn't
good.
That's going to happen.
Or make it or won't happen, whatever it is.
Wearing your favorite jersey every game day.
There's that. Yeah, well, you see, you got issues. I can tell that. I saw
I
saw your Kansas City stuff. Yeah, and so this good luck or the rabbit's foot, there's a little bit of that superstitious stuff we probably all have in ways that we don't even know about. Putting something else before
That's
God.
Good.
And I don't know. I just think that, we could knock Rachel for doing this, and that was her way of kind of maybe hanging on to her past or hanging on to some kind of inheritance. I'm not exactly sure, but it's really kind of hanging on to a blessing from an idol. It's like,
Yeah.
That don't put idols before God. And
well, I mean, and then Isaiah later on, I mean, this is, I know it's not in Genesis, but no. Isaiah says, you know, with one half, you know, a man makes an idol and prays to it and worships it, but then the other half he burns for food or then builds a house. And so like the duplicity of man of saying, well, yes, I want these things that inanimate that can't do anything when you have the living God.
Yeah.
I think you covered it a couple weeks ago where Leah uses Lord like in the sense of Yahweh, but Rachel uses Lord as just a generic God, right? Okay. And so she's still kind of, I'm not quite sure on this.
She's
Jacob,
not all
the guy's
in.
God, yeah.
Yeah, she's not all in yet. So that's a good point. Well, I think there's some different, did you have anything else you wanted to share on that? Go ahead.
One thing that this commentary brought out is that even though Rachel was the loved one as far as wives, she kind of resented her dad and her sister for taking her marital right away from her because she was married second.
Yeah.
So it shows again, she doesn't quite have a trust in God. There's probably some resentment that even though she was the loved wife, there was still a resentment towards her dad for deceiving her. Even.
Yeah. Yeah. This whole family, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you know, you think that God's going to start his line and it's going to have this pristine. It is messed up from day one.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, you know, Abraham and Sarah too old, so we bring in Hagar, and they thought they're going to fix it this way, and it's like, nope, that's not what I intended. And then we pass it down, and then he says, okay, let's say you're my sister, which was a half-truth. But, I mean, there is deception all the way through this family. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it's just a mess. And it's just like, here's what interests me. Why does God allow us to see this is his people and this is his family, if you will, and it's a mess, and he lets us see every bit of it.
Well, I think, I just got here, so I didn't get to see Dick's sermon this last week.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, with the pottery and the Japanese idea of filling it in with gold, but he's letting us see the beauty of broken pieces.
This is
what I can do with people who are broken.
Yeah.
And we see that continued on through Judah and all of these other things as we go down the line of Jesus. I mean, we get to King David, deception number one right there, one of the largest things you can do, not only murder, but then adultery,
cover it up.
And then his line of kings, what else does he do? But every single one is deceptive towards whether it's the ruling king or to the people. And then we finally get to the non-deceptive king of Jesus.
Right.
And that just shows through Genesis, I think, just like that we're all broken.
But I'm glad you brought that up because that is such a key part of this whole thing is that we all are broken. Our families are broken. There's no one that has this perfect family. And churches are broken because it's made up of broken people, right?
No perfect people allowed, right?
And God, right. And God allows us to see all these stories, but he also gets to see, they get these flashes of redemption all the way through, don't you?
Yes.
And you get to see these broken, shattered pieces put back together. And I just think it's an amazing story. And I think instead of from the outside looking in saying, well, you know, your God doesn't have perfect people. He's like, oh, you're right. But God works with imperfect people and makes solid gold come out that in ways that I don't think we could even imagine.
Right.
You know, I think I'm going to close this off, but Renee, since you're here, I did listen to your sermon while I was when I was away, and I love the idea of when you were saying that you. By the way, you broke your mom's pot.
I know. I still haven't told her yet. I haven't talked to her.
I cringed when I heard
you're like reading deception.
the family idol. You broke it.
I did. Well, I was looking for something else, but I thought this was precious to me, and it would have been easy to do something not as precious, you know, something that I bought at Walmart, but I thought this was precious to me. And I think to me, I can see how God, I'm precious to God. And when I have broken pieces, it makes me even more intentional of wanting to lovingly put those pieces back together. So that's why I did that. Because I could have chosen a Walmart piece or something.
Did you drop it? Did you bang it with a hammer? Or what'd you do?
You know what? I was intending to, you know, sometimes we know about brokenness in our lives. And I was going to, for each brokenness that I have felt in the past, hit it with a hammer, but I only need to hit it once.
No kidding.
All I need to do is, and I had it in a bag because I wanted to confine, you know, whatever little shards that it
pulled
out.
But one shot.
One shot, and it just whoosh. And I just thought, wow, I have felt that fragile at times where you know, just one little hammer shot from someone and I can feel shattered.
Yeah.
So it really didn't take that much. And so anyway, that's why I did that. It's
a perfect picture. Well, I was amazed. Well, so you take the family heirloom and you shatter it. But what you said, though, was really touching to me is that you tried to hold that piece in place and you thought you could move on. And it's like you really had to hold it there for a long time. Yeah. Took a lot more gold than you realized.
Yeah.
And that much gold covered up all the little fragments that you didn't think. You thought you needed, but you ended up not needing because of the gold. Yeah. That was worth the price of the ticket. Good job. I mean, thank your mom whenever you finally tell her.
And say,
well, thanks for the illustration because it really sunk in.
Okay. I mean, I don't know. It was just fun for me because I'm a hands-on learner. So I could imagine it, but it wasn't until I actually did it that I could just feel how
I felt it for you when you said that. It's like, what, Renee? I didn't know you broke your mom's heirloom pot. Well, anyway. Well,
and I think for healing, a lot of times we want to hurry the healing. We're like, why aren't I past this? Well, it's because God really has to hold us together for a while.
Yeah.
So that the glue that he's using in our lives, scripture, hope, love, will really saturate.
It was a powerful picture. Well, we're going to see God holding some pieces together. And he does all the way through the Old Testament. He holds these pieces together because it's a mess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Humans on our own. Well, anyway,
terrible.
We're going to land this plane here and we're going to pick it up. And I think we're going to pick it up in verse 22 and try to get to the end of this, this messed up story. In the meantime, thanks for joining us and be strong and very courageous. God bless you all.